Welcome to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightsight. We are the retro talk program for nostalgia and baby boomer stuff right here on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And we welcome you to our program today. We're so happy to have you with us. We've got a show that we hope you're going to enjoy. We're going to have some fun putting it together for you here. Well, today is Labor Day 2019. We're here in our studio broadcasting on the first Monday in September, Mike. The year's flown by real quickly, and now you folks out there will hear this program after the fact. You'll hear it after Labor Day, of course, but know that we're here on Labor Day, this first Monday in September. And Mike, you and I were talking earlier about some of the memories that come back to us from Labor Days of years past, of yore, and the year's flown by. There's just a few months left before this year ends, and lots of memories that come back from this time period when we were younger.
So true, Smitty. It is Labor Day weekend, and it does mark the end of summer officially, even though summer, as far as a season, will remain with us for another 3 weeks. But there was a certain feel about Labor Day, as I remember as a kid growing up in the 60s and 70s and going to school and having a wonderful summer and summer memories, summer vacation, just chilling out, doing nothing. All of a sudden, here comes Labor Day weekend, and you know, after today, after Labor Day, and let me remind a lot of our younger listeners that nobody went back to school till after Labor Day.
That's right, yeah.
That I know of.
Yeah.
There were no year-round schools at all, and yep. You and I both, having careers in education, Smitty, know that there's school going on all the time now, day and night, but in the 60s and probably up till the 80s, definitely in the 60s and most of the 70s and probably all the decades before, you didn't go back to school till after Labor Day. That's just the way it was.
Yeah.
And it was usually a week or two after Labor Day. But sometime in September, reality kicked in. You're back up at 6 in the morning.
Yeah.
You've got those stiff Levi's and
those new shoes that you need to be broken in.
Starchy plaid shirts, Madras belt.
Yeah.
Squeaky shoes,
but
bright, bright white socks.
Yes.
They hadn't been tainted.
Not yet.
No.
Not yet.
Didn't get the bicycle chain oil on them or anything,
that's
but you're
right.
Ready for school. You had one day left, so I don't remember Labor Day weekend being a traveling vacation, holiday vacation weekend with my family anyway, but there were a lot of families who they just gave it one last try and took off and came back on Monday, and you could see the ones who went somewhere. They brought the boats back in. They were washing their boats. And Mom, of course, was nursing everyone's sunburn.
Oh, yeah.
And next thing you know, it was time to get real, go back to school. But it was not one of my favorite 3 days. We all have a favorite long weekend.
Yeah.
I'm sure we do. And maybe that changes as you get older and you mature more. But I always enjoyed the Memorial weekend.
Yeah.
Memorial Day weekend. First of all, it was always on a Monday, and you could always look forward to the Indianapolis 500, and that was a big thing in my family. It was televised, and in my younger years, it was televised in black and white, but these were race cars that didn't have the protection or the safety mechanisms, and you almost every year you guarantee to see a fiery crash, and how exciting, how dreadful that is to think about it nowadays, but the adventure of cars going around in a big oval to a a kid 9, 10 years old was a big thing, especially dad was off from work, and usually there was a barbecue that day, and contrary or opposite, rather, to Labor Day weekend, the long weekend signaling the end of summer, Memorial Day weekend signaled the start of summer, so you had two key three-day holidays that actually were the bookends to your summer.
That's right. And then in the middle of that was the 4th of July, which is probably, I think, one of my favorite ones because There's always, as you said, Mike, there's always seemed to be a barbecue involved, some kind of a get-together with friends or family, and, of course, the fireworks and all that, which would signify, I suppose, sort of the midpoint in summer. But it is interesting. The one bookend was Memorial Day, the other bookend was Labor Day, and the other one right in the middle was 4th of July. Nevertheless, though, Labor Day, you're right. I remember that September would roll around and there'd be a little bit of dread because, oh, it won't be too long before I have to go back to school. And that was not a very pleasant thought at the time, having to get up early and do homework and deal with schoolwork and deal with, you know, getting on the bus and all that other stuff. But Labor Day weekend, apart from what you're saying, Mike, doing things with family, I, too, also don't remember that as being a traveling weekend. That was more of a stay-at-home. You know, maybe go do some shopping, maybe some school shopping, maybe finish up projects that maybe you've been working on. You've been building something over the summer as a kid, working on some, maybe our stamp collections or coin collections, or building something out in the garage and trying to finish that up and get ready because we knew our days were numbered. Our time was limited.
Yeah, you did. You had that thought, and it brought on a lot of angst and, in some cases, some panic attacks. You're going to have to familiarize yourself with a new classroom and a new teacher, and in some cases, new friends, and get back to the four walls that started at 8:01 every morning, Monday through Friday, when that little the big hand on the clock clicked over.
That's right.
8:01, and the bells started ringing. You started having to be somewhere until the coming Saturday, and that's all there was to it. And you really didn't have much to look forward to after Labor Day when school started, because the next one you had, you know, if you were young enough, you had Halloween. Halloween was, not really a holiday, but all you really had to look forward to was what was known in the up until the 60s as Armistice Day.
Yes, correct.
Which is now called Veterans Day, which is not always celebrated on Veterans Day.
Mm-hmm.
Nor with Memorial Day.
Mm-hmm.
I think you and I, when we worked in the same facility together, they would Memorial Day was always the last Monday, I believe, of May.
Yes.
Not necessarily anymore. Things have changed.
Oh, okay.
As far as celebrating, 4th of July falls on a Wednesday. You're going back to work Thursday.
That's right, yeah.
If you're in any condition to.
Yes.
Yeah, there were drinking holidays, and I did not participate. I was too young, even as I got older. They always called those amateur holidays. but there were what I guess we could call the lesser holidays, where you would get a day off from school, but it was really a negated day that unless your mom wanted to go to Sears and buy a coat or you had to go with your dad somewhere, it was one of those days where, well, okay, we got a day off tomorrow's school. And it felt really good on Friday to know you had 3 days. But presidents.
Sure.
Before President's Day, folks, there was Lincoln's birthday and there was Washington's birthday,
correct.
Now everything's combined into President's Day.
Yeah.
What do you do on President's Day? It's too cold to go to the beach.
Oh, yeah.
That's where you go and you buy your sofas. The furniture stores have hooked into President's Day, I've noticed. And not only are they hooked into it in February on President's Day, but they milk it all year. We're bringing back the President's Day sale for our recliners, and we know it's Labor Day, but we're going to still give you the discount. But you had your holidays, and you did enjoy them. You never sat there and said, it's Monday, and I have the day off from school, and sit there and grouse and complain. It was always a good thing to get a free day.
Always, a free day was always welcome, and even today, when those of us that are still working, it's good to get an extra day off and get a three-day weekend instead of just a regular two-day weekend.
Well, growing up as a TV kid, that was the entertainment. I don't ever recall going to the movies on a holiday. I'm sure there were families in L.A. that did, but mine was not one of them.
Yeah.
None of the other 300 days of the year did we go too much to the movies either, because we had the big eye in the living room.
The Cyclops in the corner.
Which brings, or the loudmouth on the screen on Labor Day as Mr. J. Lewis.
That's right.
The MDA Telethon. Right. You remember that. How could any American listening to me forget Jerry Lewis and the MDA Telethon?
The MDA Telethon. That ran for many, many years. And I remember when I was a kid, sort of being fascinated by the idea that this program was going to be going on for whatever it was, 20 hours or whatever it was, and they were going to be up all night. Of course, I didn't stay up all night to watch it, but I'd watch a little bit of it. in the evening. It was interesting because it was live television. It was basically a big variety show. A big variety show, of course, making a pitch continuously for people to make donations to the Muscular Dystrophy Association. And it was sort of one of those things that was part of Labor Day. You didn't have Labor Day without the Muscular Dystrophy Telethon.
And it was going all the time, as I recall.
Yeah.
I guess our good buddy Dave Gruitt he's a fantastic resource, especially for Los Angeles television. He's been posting stuff for the last couple of days about the telethon, the memories on KTLA. But you're right, that was going. You could go to bed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, time to go to bed. No more TV for you, Gilbert. Time to go to bed.
Yeah.
And Gunsmoke was over and this and that. And you get up tomorrow, and there's Jerry Lewis. He looks like he's in the same tuxedo, and he doesn't look any worse for the wear. But instead of Ernie Borgnine on the show last night, he had Martha Ray.
Yeah, that's right.
So
yeah.
He was a never-ending stream of talent, notables, and celebrities that would come in, and it would go straight through to what, Sunday night late,
It would go to late Sunday afternoon or something, late Monday afternoon? Yeah, Monday afternoon, I think it was.
That was the nonstop for programming.
Yeah, it was. And I always, as a younger kid, I was expected to, tune in the following morning and see Jerry Lewis with his hair all uncombed and his necktie hanging and tired and worn out. But you're right. He didn't look any worse for the wear. It was real interesting. It was, one of those events that you saw on television that was pretty unusual. So it certainly attracted my attention as a kid, because being interested in radio and TV even from a very young age, not everybody shared the enthusiasm or the interest in the telethon. There were people that you and I might know, people that really were not interested in it and, in fact, did not watch it at all. But as an event, say what you will, whether you're a Jerry Lewis fan or not, say what you will, it was interesting, and it was a very interesting part of television history. It was a staple that we saw every year for many, many years. I think it began, back in the early 60s?
Oh, absolutely.
Something like that, and then went a number of years back. Jerry Lewis has passed away now, of course, but a number of years back it ended, and I don't know whether they even have those telethons anymore.
Probably. We should have done a little better research.
Yeah.
I can guarantee you in the early 60s or mid-60s, he was the fixture on Labor Day viewing, and for what was it? 20 plus hours, and I guess they would go dark for a few hours, but 3-4 in the morning.
Really?
They would go to some type, or they would do a tape of something from the early in the day, and he'd catch them. But, for 20 plus hours a day, and, whether you liked them or not, and Jerry would come on, he'd sing and joke and mug and play ringmaster to just a horde of celebrities, as he appealed, of course, with the reason they're on the air, to the viewers to dig deep in their pockets and donate to the Muscular Dystrophy Association. But as times changed, as our culture and our society changed, that type of approach to that type of issue, using that type of medium, just became wrong on so many levels. Won't go deeply into it, but as Jerry got older, too, his persona and attitude changed, and I do know some people that worked in production, in stage production, said he was just, after about 15 hours nonstop, he could become a real bad piece of work to deal with.
I can imagine,
And, with the new realities of television, and as I remember, and you probably do too, Smitty, most of our listeners who remember the telethon, Jerry Lewis, he'd dominate the show at all times.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And he'd deliver a blend of showbiz, schmaltz, and true life, these touching stories of people who had this horrible, dreadful disease in their families. And, whether you liked it or cringed, it was live television at its most live, Smitty. There were no rehearsals. Everything was done. And as the hours went by and the first day passed, old Jerry, he'd just get more cranky and tearful.
Mm-hmm.
And
oh, yeah.
He'd start pleading with viewers to give us more money, help us. We need more money. And then they'd get a little old lady out in San Fernando Valley somewhere who would throw in $5, and he'd get up there and he'd start weeping.
Oh, yeah.
And when you're a little kid, it's okay, that's Jerry Lewis, and it just started becoming rather, I won't say creepy, but a little uncomfortable year after year to watch the man age. There are more reasons. I guess in 2011 was the last telethon.
Okay.
But, Smitty, you're the tech side of the studio here. I had a question, and I know several of the fans that I know that private messaged me. That telethon went on across the country.
Mm-hmm.
How did it go across live if we were 3 hours behind? Would they just send live link up?
Oh, it was live, okay. Yeah. Yeah, it was live coast to coast, okay. Yeah. So you figure it was, well, it had to be live, number yeah. one. Number two, it didn't really matter at that particular moment that we out here on the West Coast would be 3 hours behind the East Coast because people were getting the same entertainment. If it ended here earlier in the evening, it ended later in the evening, obviously, on the East Coast. The distribution, of course, in the earlier days would have been through the telephone company, through telephone lines, just like the networks. Now, basically, what it was, Mike, was it was a specially put-together television network is what it was. And the early days would have been done through the coaxial cable system from the telephone company and microwave relays. And, of course, in later years, it was done via satellite. So the local stations around the country would just basically either in the earlier days have that feed brought in by the telephone company, by telco as it was known then, and then in later years they would just dial in a satellite receiver to pick up that feed. Because as you remember, Mike, all of the local stations would do a local break. They take over the air for 15, 20 minutes, and they'd maybe have some local celebrities. In fact, our good friend Shotgun Tom Kelly used to do that on the Muscular Dystrophy telethons. They had designated time periods when the local stations could cut in for 15, 20, maybe even a half hour, do their own local segment, and then cut back to the national telethon with Jerry Lewis.
I know the first telethon, Jerry Lewis telethon, originated on only one station, that was a New York station.
New York station, right.
And I checked this out. I did have some notes, and actually he did not host the MDA Labor Day Telethon until 1966.
66, that's correct, yeah. Mike, yes.
Okay, good. Mm-hmm. And then you have it piped everywhere, but you also had local telethons all the time, apparently. And 66 rolls around, and they have a good roll at it, but I'm wondering now if just because you saw the Jerry Lewis telethon on KTLA, if those parts were originating from Los Angeles, because it appeared they'd switch over. I remember Guy Lombardo was at Penn Station.
Really?
And and this would be in the late 60s.
Okay.
But it was probably roll-in tape. It might have been from the day before.
It could have been, sure, yeah.
So we say it was purely live, not necessarily true then.
No, I think that they were roll-in segments, and I know they did have film segments. If memory serves, Mike, they had roll-in segments where they would highlight some local group that was working with muscular dystrophy patients and things like that. So, and those were opportunities for Jerry Lewis and for some of the staff to go, you know, to go use the bathroom or get a snack or something while they were running maybe a 10-15 minute film of something or other.
Okay.
But I mean, the majority of it, I think most of the performances were done live.
Well, everybody who watched those over the years will have their favorite times, their favorite celebrities, their favorite moments, and even from Jerry Lewis having his emotional meltdowns to the guests that would come on stage with him, they look like deer in the headlights.
Oh, yeah.
Got total stage freeze, and it could be they just didn't. There were probably very limited teleprompter activity. You probably had grease boards.
Yeah.
But probably the biggest moment in all the history of the Labor Day telethon was, and as a lot of you folks, especially movie buffs, entertainment buffs, that share with us, Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin, unfortunately. Well, fortunately, they were one of the best movie comedy teams around in the early 50s. Unfortunately, they had a split, and they broke up. So probably one of the biggest telethon moment in Labor Day MDA telethon history would be Frank Sinatra getting up and hooking these two guys back up.
That's right. That was perhaps probably the biggest moment in telethon history, in the MDA telethon history. Happened in 1976, as you mentioned, Mike, and it was, that clip is on YouTube. I've seen it.
It is. It's one of the highest watched.
Yeah.
Because you got your Frank Sinatra fans, your Jerry Lewis fans.
Your Dean Martin fans.
Dean Martin fans.
And
Sinatra brought it out and put it on together, probably the most electric, emotional moments in live television history.
Yeah.
And probably celebrity history is getting those two to, they hadn't talked for decades.
For a long time.
At least a decade or more.
Yeah, and he brought him, and Sinatra was real smooth about it. He says, I have a friend that I'd like to bring out that would like to be on your show. And all of a sudden, here comes Dean with a cigarette in his hand, and Jerry Lewis just starts, you know, giddy. You know, he just gets giddy.
Yeah.
And they hug, and I think the first thing Jerry Lewis says to him is, well, how are you? Something like that. You know, just some very, something you wouldn't expect, you know, but that's how he got into it. So,
yes. Yeah. Evidently, afterwards, they did do a backstage, and they both were gentlemanly. Mm-hmm. There was still some ice to be broken.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Jerry did the what you'd mentioned, his line, and then backstage, Dean Martin said, so anyway, as I was telling you, and he just continued on with the conversation that they had shortly before they decided to split up. So very interesting. Musical guests were always one of the favorites.
Yeah.
You'd wait for the schmaltz and all of the snarky things. Jerry Lewis, as the listeners can gather, is probably not one of my favorite comedians. But still, you'd wait and wait and wait and see who was going to come on next. And just a partial list here. Mm-hmm. Count Basie, the Bee Gees, Tony Bennett, Clint Black, John Bon Jovi. I'm sure maybe it's not a mistake. No, Garth Brooks, Mariah Carey, Ray Charles, Cher, Chicago. Now, this was not in the 60s, folks. A lot of these folks were
Are later ones, yeah.
Yeah. But I remember in the early years, Eartha Kitt, who was a very, very prominent actress and singer. Of course, Michael Jackson, you had Tom Jones. I remember watching John Lennon.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Came in by himself and just came in. I think he stayed 3-4 minutes, but made a cameo. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure he was crazy. But you don't know who you would see.
Yeah.
Even at 10:15 on the first night of the event, who would be walking across that stage.
Yeah.
I remember Tina Turner, I believe it was.
Yeah.
Came out and sat high and maybe sang a few bars and took off.
I'm not sure, Mike, but I tend to believe that maybe a lot of these people would just stop by. They'd be maybe finish a show that night and they'd come by and say, hey, well, we'll come by and do a 10-minute cameo and say hello or maybe sing one song and then be on our way. It's amazing how everyone got behind this. I mean, my understanding, Mike, is that nobody got paid. It was a volunteer thing. So everybody would jump on this bandwagon to be part of the telethon. It's really amazing. I don't think you'd really be able to do something like that today.
Other than just really high-end five-star productions like We Are the World or Live Aid, these would become major international events. We're talking about local TV stations carrying this telethon, and a number, and in the 60s, you didn't have 800 toll-free numbers or 888s or 866s or 978. Oh, wait, that's for something else. But you would have local numbers. You would call, and again, volunteers, you would have a panel.
Mm-hmm.
And Tina Turner would come out and sing a couple of verses from something, Rolling on the River, and then she'd go sit with everybody else and work the phones.
Take a phone call,
So you could call in. Which I must admit, I did so under false pretenses, just to see who would pick up the phone. And I got Wally Cox.
Really?
Mr. Peepers.
Wow.
One time.
How about that?
It was Wally Cox.
Wow.
And I'll give you a Wally Cox moment, if there's such one.
All right.
First thing, is this Wally Cox? Wally Cox answers, yeah, it is, kid. How much are you giving? Real business.
Okay.
He was not Mr. Peepers.
Oh, okay. Wow.
He was Mr. I'm going to slap you off the phone if you don't come up with $5, kid. Or don't call back. Yeah.
So what'd you do, Mike? You quickly hang up? Or?
I hung up, and as I stuffed my little chubby beating heart back into my chest, thought that the police were going to come because I had committed some type of crime by falsely impersonating somebody donating to the telethon just to see if... hopefully it would have been Kim Novak, but I got Mr. Peepers.
Okay, well.
But those are one of the things you could call. You talk to somebody.
Sure. Yep. It was pretty amazing to see them get up there on the phone panel and take. And, of course, you, Mike, when you were growing up, you were watching it locally in Los Angeles, which is right there in the entertainment capital. So there's no telling who could have been there. There could have been all kinds of personalities there that would have been picking up the phone.
Well, L.A., sure. People would come across and you'd have local personalities, too, local radio personalities.
Sure.
Yeah, I remember my good friend who's no longer with us, Bill Balance, one of the colored radio gentlemen.
Sure.
Fabulous 40 KFWB came by and just had a cup of coffee and donut and told me that he went up there and Bill Balance's story was telling me what Jerry Lewis's handshake was like.
Okay.
But I forgot what it was like.
Okay, well.
So I must not have been impressed.
Yes, and we'll never know now.
We will never know. They both took the secret with them.
They took it with them. Mike, I remember when we still had the telethons, I have a friend who used to work for a television station here in town who worked for the station that was carrying the telethon in later years. And I actually went and sat in on one of the local cut-ins that they do. They had a live audience. And I forget, it may have even been, I don't know, I can't remember who was there. Shotgun Tom may have actually been there. I don't know. But basically, in the studio, and you sat, they had an audience section, and they would bring in people out, and they'd tell you when to applaud and whatever, and they would say, okay, locally we've collected so much for muscular dystrophy, and they would present local celebrities who would do the cut-ins, you know, and who would talk about what was happening locally. Again, maybe 15, 20 minutes, 25 minutes, whatever, then they would switch back to the national telethon with Jerry Lewis. So I remember sitting in on that many years ago.
Oh, sure. Now that, yes, because I believe that would have originated from KTLA.
In Los Angeles,
In Los Angeles, in our case.
Yeah.
Because there were people that I knew that would have tickets to go sit in the audience. And it was the same audience area at KTLA that George Putnam would do his talk back show, and they would have live and even kids shows. Kids would sit up in the bandstand or in the grandstand, rather, in the seats, and there was a big glittering sign that would say applause.
Yeah.
Now stop. Yeah. But all live audience, live entertainment, live, and well, in early television you had more live than you did pre-production,
yeah, exactly.
But that was always a good memory that, you know, on a weekend there was something. Memorial weekend, you had the Indy 500.
Mm-hmm,
Of course, Easter, which is one of the lesser weekends, and I say that only because there was not an extra day attached
to it.
But you always had Edward G. Robinson about 5 o'clock on ABC.
The Ten Commandments.
That's right. Yeah, every year.
Every year. That was a tradition, too.
Christmas, of course, It's a Wonderful Life.
Yep, It's a Wonderful Life.
And the little boy with the BB gun.
Yes.
And but you think about it, you think about going back to school and all the sensories that come with it, maybe the getting back to school, the first day of school, in my case, coming back to junior high, now called middle school, smelling those cinnamon rolls that the ladies would make about 7 in the morning, and the aroma would waft out to the quad, and those frozen chocolate malts at lunchtime. And after the first day, going back to school wasn't so bad.
That's right.
Especially when I was assigned a seat next to Becky Booth.
Oh, there you go. Becky Booth, whom you've mentioned before on previous occasions,
yes,
Mike.
So, and we'll mention again.
I'm sure you will. Did you ever have the, when you were going to school, did they ever have the chewy peanut butter? Did they have those?
Yeah.
I love those.
The chewy peanut butter.
Look forward to those.
Student store.
Oh, yes.
Everything was 6 cents.
Yes, it was.
Not a nickel. I don't know how they figured that. I don't know. Maybe the principal got a penny.
The milk was 6 cents.
Got some bigger.
Six cents.
Yeah, it was 6 cents. Cinnamon roll was 6 cents, and you could get a box of Red Hots or Boston baked beans for 6 cents, and we called that sneeze ammo because you'd sit in the back and the teacher was writing on the chalkboard and you'd get a handful of Red Hots and sneeze as you threw them. Sneezy treats.
I think that extra penny must have gone to the general fund, Mike.
Yeah, I did. Well, that probably went, you know, they had to pay the candy people.
Yeah,
they had to pay the help, and maybe that went to get some of the, you know, book bags or
exactly,
something.
Exactly, a penny per purchase. Well, anyway, folks, we're reaching the end of our program today, and we hope that we brought back a few memories for you. Labor Day and the Jerry Lewis telethon and getting ready to go back to school and all that fun stuff. So if we have, why don't you drop us a line? Our email address is galaxymoonbeamnightside@gmail.com. galaxymoonbeamnightside@gmail.com. Our website is galaxymoonbeamnightside. Don't forget our show is available on iTunes, on Mixcloud, and now on Google Podcasts. So those of you who are Android users can now dial in and listen to us on Google Podcasts. And, of course, our Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside page on Facebook, where we hope that you will friend us, and that way you'll get all our updates and you will be able to know when we do a new show, when we have a new show that's ready to be released. So we thank you so much for joining us. We've had a lot of fun during this half hour, and we hope you did too. I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And thank you for joining us on Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
This is the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.